Okay, so first of all, thank you to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak at the String Conference. I'm going to talk about some work done in collaboration with people from Madrid and Munich. So, even if it's an old question, I think in the last years, more and more people are getting interested on the properties that distinguish the string landscape from the swampland. So what are the constraints that an effective theory has to satisfy in order to be embedded in a consistent theory of quantum gravity? And for instance, there has been a lot of interest on constructing theories of an action having a transplanckian field variation. And this is because two reasons. First, because they are important for phenomenology, for large field inflation or cosmological relaxation of the electroweak scale. And second, because it's very hard to embed these models in string theory. And all the difficulties arising in doing this has led to think that maybe there is some underlying constraint from quantum gravity that forbids to have a transplanckian field range related to the weak gravity conjecture or something else. So in this talk, I'm going to talk instead about the refined swampland conjecture, the constraints that come from there, which is a generalization of a conjecture that already appeared in the paper of Oguri Bafa, which says that an effective theory coming from string theory is valid only in the finite domain of the moduli space, because if we move parametrically far away, there will be a tower, an infinite tower of states which become light and invalidate the effective theory. So how these constraints applies to inflation, which we need axions. So let me focus on axion monodromy, which is a proposal in which one can achieve a transplanckian, a large field variation, even if the fundamental periodicity of the axion is subplanckian. And, in this case, the weak gravity conjecture cannot rule out the models, but they are still full of difficulties and problems that are related to back reaction issues that appear when we try to embed the model in string theory. So let me consider, for instance, a supergravity generalization in which, apart from the inflaton, I have a suction, so a non-periodic scalar, which parametrizes the Kähler metric of the inflaton. And the thing is that when we move the inflaton away from the minimum, the vacuum expectation value of the suction might change, and this will back react on the Kähler metric of the inflaton. So if the suction is proportional to the inflaton B for large field, we will have that the proper field distance of the inflaton will scale as the logarithm of the field itself. And as Eran Parti and his students remarked last year, this behavior is very similar to the one appearing in the swampland conjecture, because we will have again a tower of states that whose mass is parametrized by the suctions, but that will scale in this way with the inflaton, so they will become exponentially light for large field, and they will invalidate the effective theory at a critical value parametrized by lambda, which parametrizes how important are these back reaction effects. So the main question is, what is lambda? When this happens? When does this happen? So the refined swampland conjecture, formulated by Eran, says that lambda is always of order one, which means that the effective theory always breaks down at the Planck scale, and we cannot have transplanckian field variations. Now, can we check this in some way? Well, at first, at least, we can try to find evidence in favor or against this in concrete string compactifications. So let me consider flash compactifications of type 2 in Orientifold Calabi-Yau threefolds. And, we get that this logarithmic behavior always appears. And it's quite remarkable that for axions that belong to the closed string sector, the lambda corresponding to this variation is always of order one and flux, it's independent of the fluxes. So in this case, it's true that the variation effects always become important at the Planck scale, and we cannot have an effective theory valid for a transplanckian field excursion. Now, we also saw that this is not the end of the study, because if we introduce, for instance, open string fields, lambda becomes flux dependent, because indeed it depends on the hierarchy, the mass hierarchy between the inflaton and the suctions. So if we are able to generate this hierarchy, in principle, we can delay the back reaction effects by tuning these fluxes, no? By generating the hierarchy far away in field distance. Now, the problem that we also saw that in the concrete models that we could explicitly check, that we could stabilize all the moduli, this tuning was not possible. So in models based on oriented fault toroidal compactifications, we could not achieve this tuning without losing parametric control of the effective theory. And well, Florian Wolf will present a poster about this. So let me summarize. We have seen that back reaction on the inflaton metric in type 2 compactifications leads to this logarithmic scaling of the field distance at large values, which implies a breakdown of the effective theory consistent with this Swan-Planck conjecture. And in principle, it can be delayed by inducing a mass hierarchy between the inflaton and the axions, but in the models that have been able to check so far, this hierarchy cannot be realized without losing parametric control of the effective theory, so in a more subtle way, but it's still consistent with this refined Swan-Planck conjecture. And the task for the future is try to check if this tuning can be realized in more elaborated Calabi-Yau compactifications, or this constraint on the field range is a universal property of the string landscape. So thank you very much for your attention.
Any questions? Okay. If there are no questions, let's thank Irene again.